A very good morning, class. Today we are going to talk about the Gupta dynasty. As I told you in the class, that Gupta dynasty period is known to be the golden period in the history of India. In this topic, we are going to talk about what was the time period when the Gupta rulers ruled, who were the kings, and what were their achievements. How was the administration system during the Gupta dynasty period? And what special effect they had that the foreigners who came to India, who came over here, they even praised different connotations for the Indian administrators or the Gupta kings. And why was it known to be a golden period in the history of India? That is the big question that we must know, that what actual performance was there, or what actual improvisation was there, what was the actual dedication that led to such a high growth, or there was such a big glory to the whole history that the historians had to write this period as the golden period. So this we see the hierarchy system is there. Hierarchy system, when I say, a family tree is followed on, wherein a grandfather, father and the son, they rule the dynasty, but in the most efficient manner. It's not that I'm a king and my son will be a king. That was not there. The son was efficient enough, he had the capabilities, he had the etiquettes of a king, he had the qualities of a king, then only he sat for the throne, or he ascended the throne. So that beauty actually we see in the Gupta dynasty. It's not that the family tree is there, or family hierarchy is there, that the king's son will be king only. That system is not there. The person had qualities, different qualities which a king must have, they have. So we'll see the different kings and their qualities here. Like, it was started by grandfather, ruled by father, finished off with the son. So this was the basic system which we see in the Gupta period. If you talk about the period of the Gupta dynasty, it actually began from 320 AD to 440 AD. In short, we can say from 3rd to 4th century. And during the 4th century only, it got its wings to the golden era. Means there was during the establishment year, the dynasty was established, there were some loopholes, there were some ifs and buts, but with slow growth rate, it started achieving and making a milestone in the history of India. And by the end of the 4th century, or by the beginning of the 4th century, it recalled, or it jotted down its history, that historians had to remember this phase or this period in the golden period. We are going to talk about the administration, how a king had different qualities, how was the administration system, how the military was managed, how was the life of the people, what were the religious philosophies of the kings, how they were towards the different religions, what was the concept of Jainism and Buddhism, which had a high impression during the modern era, so what was their value now. Then the place of women in the history of Gupta period, what was, how was women ruled, whether they were dominant or whether the things were in their favor. So that we'll see in this topic. So I shall begin with the Gupta dynasty, page number 63, chapter number 9. The Kushanas ruled till about 230 AD. Sri Gupta, a local chief of Magadha under the Kushana, founded the Gupta dynasty. It was founded by, the Gupta dynasty was founded by Sri Gupta. Gupta dynasty was founded by Sri Gupta. Sri Gupta, a local chief of Magadha under the Kushana, founded the Gupta dynasty in the 3rd century AD. The real date is 320 AD, but we call it in short as 3rd century AD. The dynasty reached the height of its glory in the 4th century AD, and under a great ruler's like Chandragupta I, Samudragupta, and Chandragupta Gupta Vikramaditya. So these were different rulers who made a valuable impression, a valuable effect in the history. That is why their names are known or renowned. They had an important place in the history of India. It's because of their efforts only that the era or the period of 320 to 414 was known as Golden Period or the Golden Period in the history of India. So one by one we'll see about different rulers. The first is Chandragupta I from 320 AD to 335 AD. It does not matter what
the is.
So, Chandragupta I. The Gupta era is believed to have begun in 320 AD when Chandragupta I ascended the throne of Magadha. It is believed that from 320 AD only the Chandragupta, Chandragupta I actually ascended the throne and the era or the period of the Gupta dynasty started. Under him, Magadha again rose to prominence. He was the initiator who actually took a great initiative to take the glory to the highest level, and that is why the king made a simultaneous effort to achieve the glory from every ground. Chandragupta ruled from Pataliputra. Pataliputra was the capital that we already know. He extended his political influence from Magadha to Prayag and Saketa, that is in Ayodhya, in UP. He remained in power till 335 AD. So different regions, different corners of the country was taken care, and he ruled for a small period of 15 years only. But the period does not matter. Your achievements matter. It does not mean if you have a lengthy service time, you will dedicate much to the society, you will dedicate much to the subjects. The short span of time only, but a big achievement was let down. So he took a direct control over every corner, and there were efforts were made to take care of the subjects. His glory was passed on to his son Samudragupta. Samudragupta ruled from 335 AD to 375 AD. Chandragupta I was succeeded by his son Samudragupta, often regarded as the greatest ruler of the Gupta dynasty. See, Samudragupta, out of all, Chandragupta I, Samudragupta and Vikramaditya, out of all the three kings, Samudragupta is known to be the greatest king, the greatest ruler in the history of India. The reason is that he had a direct control over the military system. He had a strong control over the military system. When a military system is strong enough, no country or no neighboring country would even look for the invasion or even try to invade you. They will not try to attack you when you have a strong military system. So that was the political philosophy of Samudragupta. He believed that when you have a strong administration, strong protection of the boundaries, no country or no neighboring country will look into your matter and then will attack you. So that was the basic concept. We get information about Samudragupta's region mainly from the coins and inscriptions. Told you in the history, if you want to make your mark, if you want the coming generations to know about you, the thing that you have to follow is that whatever work you perform, whatever achievements you have to jot down somewhere. That jotting down is done in the inscription, the form of inscriptions that is written in the rock pillars or pillars somewhere. And even in the coins, where in the era or where in the golden pages are shown in the coin sets. The Allahabad inscription, for example, praises Samudragupta's military achievements. It was composed in the Sanskrit language by the court poet Harisena. See, the Samudragupta's military achievement was renowned or was recollected in, was written down in the Allahabad pillar. Allahabad pillar is there, wherein it was written down in Sanskrit language by a court poet known as Harisena. He was a poet in the Samudragupta's court only, so he only jotted down, he only wrote down all his achievements in the Sanskrit language. Now, the qualities I told you, a king must have certain qualities to be a king. It's not that since my father was a king that I will be a king. No, I must have the etiquette, I must have those qualities. So why was the battle or battle passed on to from Chandragupta I to Samudragupta? The reason was Samudragupta was an efficient ruler, was a warrior, was a poet, was a musician, was a learned person. He had different qualities. That is why he came out as a king. And the history renowns or recalls him as the greatest king in the history of India. The quality that Samudragupta had. Samudragupta was a warrior, a person who lead in front during the war time, a scholar, a person who is very literate, who is very knowledgeable, a musician, a poet, and above all, a good ruler. A good ruler is one who looks after the matters of the subject and takes efficient care of his subject and manages the affairs in the most prominent manner. He was a Hindu but was tolerant towards Buddhists and Jains. I told you that Buddhists and Jains had their own philosophy, they were ruling or they were spreading their own messages, religious policies to different parts during the modern time. By the time the Guptas entered, they did not have so much of love or so much of affection towards the Buddhist and Jain, but they had a soft corner. They had a soft corner. The reason was that since it was coming from the generations, so they did not believe in just moving out or living as it is, but they gave them the place, they contributed a little, their devotion to the religion was little, but they had their own faith, their own respect for their Hindu god. The goddess were Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu. They were inclined towards the worship of Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu. So class, I am going to stop over here, and next class we shall discuss about Samudragupta's military campaign. Why was he known to be a strong ruler or strong military holder? Because he moved to different parts. Okay, so we'll discuss about this in the next class. Thank you, class.